Hello and welcome to a new episode of Now Magazine. Today we have a lot of interesting segments, so stay with us. Our first segment is Story of the Week, and in it I'll be interviewing Dr. Yasser Hegazi, Professor of Electrical Engineering, and we will be learning more about his story of success. It will be followed by the Eye of Horus, and in it we will be visiting the Palace of Prince Charles. As for the Culture Review, in it we will be attending the Oman Bright Show Carnival. Finally, in memories, we will be commemorating the memory of the late celebrity Egyptian singer, the planet of the East, as she was known, Umm Kulthum. Now it's time for Story of the Week. In today's Story of the Week, I'll be interviewing Dr. Yasser Hegazi. Dr. Yasser is a professor of electrical engineering, also he's vice president for student affairs. Sir, welcome with us. Well, first of all, before we start talking about your career, I'd like first to choose to study electrical engineering.
I love engineering. This is number one. Mm-hmm. And I was actually attracted to the fact that electrical engineering is related to physics. Mm-hmm. And when I was young, I was fascinated by the physical phenomena of everything that's surrounding us. And I found out that studying electrical engineering will enable me to understand what's going on in my life, mm-hmm. and maybe to add something or to contribute to this science.
Yes, and once you graduated and you graduated with honors, you pursued your master's degrees. Would you tell me more about your master's degrees and about the scholarships you received?
Actually, I was a top student since I was in primary school, so I was the top of the government when I was in the sixth primary, and then top in the preparatory school. And I actually was a graduate of one of what they call school just for top-ranked students from all the Egyptian governments. Mm-hmm. It was in early in the 70s and the 80s, where the first and second top ranked from each government joined the school. Mm-hmm. It's called the School of Top Ranked or Distinguished. I don't remember the name or how it was named.
Yes.
And in this school, I learned actually that science is not limited to what we get in the classroom. Mm-hmm. It's beyond this, so we have to expand our knowledge by reading, by exercising, by trying things out. And that make me actually qualified to get to the university. So I achieved high grades in the high school, and I joined Ain Shams University. And I was one of the top students throughout my study in Ain Shams University, and the top ranked in the year of graduation. It was not only for my class of graduation, but also was the whole university.
Yes.
So I received from the Syndicate of Engineering a certificate afterwards for my achievement, and that was, I consider this was the my biggest achievement at that time.
Yes, I understand that your master's was in online identification. It's a long title, but that's the summary of it, I understand. Yes. Would you tell us more about that thesis, please?
One of the challenging tasks in general when you're dealing with dynamic systems is how you control the system, how you let the system perform the way you want the system to perform. In order to do this, you have to know the main characteristics and the main variables of your system, and you have to identify them very clearly in order to have the power to govern these variables. So my master topic was a method of identification of the main parameters of the synchronous and the synchronous machine for the people is the main generator that produces power everywhere in the world. Power produced everywhere by the machine that we call the alternator or the synchronous machine. So my master's was how to model this machine in a way that enable us to control the machine and be able to govern the variables of this machine.
Yes. Also, you pursued continuing your studies, and you did also your PhD degree after that, and you did a lot of research in that field as well. So, was the PhD different, or it continued on the same path?
No, actually, I didn't stop the research, and I was happy to go into the same direction, but I got a scholarship from the University of Waterloo in Canada. In 1992, a PhD scholarship. And in Canada, they have a big project that includes control and analysis of what we call the electrical power systems. Where, there were problems facing the large network that's supplying the electrical power to everyone. And the research was how to mitigate these problems. So I actually switched to electrical power engineering in Canada throughout my scholarship for PhD, and I had a direction on what we call the electric power quality, and specifically on the harmonic analysis, which is a big part and important part of the electric power quality.
Now, being in Canada, and Canada is known, of course, as one of the advanced countries in terms of computer, electricity, and electronics in general, to what extent at that time did you find that you benefited from it first? And then do you feel that the technology in Canada, are we far behind? Are we equal? How do you evaluate Egypt in regards to Canada, for instance?
My first experience in Canada was a good one. I gained a lot of confidence because that our background is very strong and competitive. So I didn't have any lack of information or any weakness point that made me less than the average people who are taking a PhD. I would say we have advantages of being very strong in math and analytical analysis over all the students from everywhere in the world. But of course, Canada was a little bit ahead of Egypt in dealing with the technology in general and the dependence on the technology, because we export technology, we use it, but they produce it, so they are getting to use it in daily life aspects. But doesn't take long to get adapted to the system there and be part of the system, and that was not a challenging task, was a good task.
Did you stay in Canada?
Actually, I left Egypt in 1992 and I came back in 2004, so almost 12 years.
That's a long time.
Yeah, it is. That was 12 enjoyable years, actually, and full of benefits.
So would you tell me, what did you do there? In addition, of course, to your PhD.
Sure, yeah. I finished my PhD in 1996. And during that time, I was working in some research projects inside the University of Waterloo. And I got an offer to work in the industry, and I found it something good for me and new to get industrial experience. So I joined the industry for some time, and then I got an offer from my university to come back as a lecturer. So I went back to the University of Waterloo, and I spent there some time teaching and doing research again. And this was the most productive time in my life, I guess, from the academic point of view.
Now, in terms of your field, so you're more into computers or anything that's electrical in general, machinery, which part of it are you interested in?
We are in the high power part, because electrical actually goes from the very low power devices into the high voltage and high power engineering. So I am in the high power side, which we are called in general power engineers. So yes. My field is electrical power engineers.
Actually, that's quite important right now in Egypt, such a field of expertise, with emphasis since presidency of President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi. He has stressed on power, he has stressed on trying to make Egypt a power hub with all the, whether it's through electricity, it's through solar energy, even natural gas, and we're still working on it. And even right now, there are so many, with the Mediterranean natural gas, you know, the big find of that discovery of the well, actually work on it. Now, how can we benefit from such expertise, your expertise, to create Egypt, or to make Egypt an electricity hub or a power hub? And to what extent is that feasible?
Of course, the importance of electricity for the advances of any country is remarkable. Yes. No one can deny it.
Do we have the potential here in Egypt to be a power hub?
Do we have the potential? Yes, we do. But actually, there are many ways to produce power. Renewable energy is one of these ways. And we do have the potential to produce much more than we are producing now. It is not a cost-effective production for now, but it is going to be much better in the near future. And we have to start in this direction. This is one direction. The other traditional or classical power generation, which depends on the natural gas or fossil fuels or these things, are not actually our favorite, because we have to import the main source of energy. And we are switching somehow to the nuclear power energy, which will cover the needs, and we will have surplus that will enable us to actually advance in the industry and open more markets. But can we, as Egypt, be a hub and export power to neighboring countries, for example? I would say this is a bit difficult. We can have links with other countries to exchange power, because our behavior towards using electricity is different from the behaviors of our neighboring countries. So we can benefit from this, exchanging the power during the peak time, our peak, and sending them some power during their peak. And the time difference and peaks make it this might be a good deal or good contracts for us, but very difficult for that does not have extra natural resources to be a leading country in exporting power.
Now, you came back here and you started teaching. And before that, you were in Canada for a while. So did you take and benefit from or transport the techniques you've learned in Canada to Egypt as a professor, or did you follow the classic Egyptian way of teaching?
It's a mix of the two. But definitely we learned from our professors, especially the professors taught us in Ain Shams how to teach, because Egyptians are well known for being excellent teachers. How to be organized, what it takes in order to prepare a lecture and stand in front of the students very confident. But we learned from Canada how to use technology to deliver the material, and how actually to involve the students in the education. So I mix between the two. I think what I learned from Canada is students are part of their education. So I am not the one who should tell them what to do. They should be involved, they should contribute. And at the same time, using technology makes things easier for us. So I'm adapting different technologies. I'm using web pages for each course I teach. I have direct contact with my students all the time. So these are, I guess, I learned it from being an instructor in Canada and brought to my classes in Cairo.
Hegezi, Professor of Electrical Engineering and the Vice President of the Student Affairs. Thank you very much for this interview, but we're still going talking about the story of success in the next episode.
My pleasure. Thank you for visiting me today.
Thank you. Now it's time for the Eye of Horus. It's time to head to Islamic Cairo, in particular to the area of the Sufaya Street, to visit together Prince Tas Palace. Actually, it's a Mamluk palace that dates to the 14th century. Now let's enjoy it together. The Emir Tas Palace or Prince Tas Palace is located in the area of Islamic Cairo at the intersection of the Saliba and Sufaya streets. The Emir Tas Palace is also known as Dar Tas, meaning the home of Tas, and it is one of the most well-known Mamluk palaces remaining in historic Cairo. Tas al-Nasiri was at Mamluk of the Muhammad Qalawun army. However, he rose through the ranks and became the chief of council or Emir Majlis. Prince Tas helped Salah ad-Din Saleh Muhammad Qalawun to rise through the ranks and become Sultan in 1351 AD. In 1355, Emir Tas, then Grand de Widar, was imprisoned only to be released and afterwards made governor of Aleppo. He was sentenced to prison a second time in 1357 and yet again released due to the good relations he held with Yalbua al-Qasiqi. This palace was built by Emir Tas in 1352 to celebrate his marriage to the Sultan al-Nasir Muhammad's daughter. However, not even his wealth and high rank could save him from falling victim to malicious conspiracies and facing imprisonment on the previously mentioned occasions. For this reason, Emir Tas never got a real chance to settle into his establishment. Finally, he was forced to renounce his magnificent palace and travel in search of tranquility and peace of mind away from the city of Cairo. This took him far from the threats he felt surrounding him in Egypt. He lived for some years in Jerusalem and then Damascus till he died. The palace is a significant complex of buildings, annexes, and gardens. Both the eastern and western sides of it are enclosed, giving it a secluded and private atmosphere, while the whole complex is surrounded by a big stone wall, keeping all its inner courtyards and quarters out of the sight of passers-by. The main entrance is located on As-Sufaya Street, a central portal richly decorated with stalactites flanked by two secondary arcs. Today, only three quarters of the facade and entrance are visible as the street level has been elevated over the years and the lower parts of the structure are now partially buried. The ground floor is occupied by craftsmen's shops all along the facade. The western and main entrance was also used as an entrance for carriages. It led directly to the central courtyard, which was also near to the stables of the complex. Though the entrance has similar features to that of the Yashbak Palace, it has a more simple style than the monumental architectural aspects of the luxurious decorative style of the other. The eastern entrance is characterized by its simple architectural style. The detailed and rich decorative ornaments appear only in the interior chambers and courtyard walls of the palace. The inner courtyard of the palace has four entrances, two of which are the original ones. They are located on the east and west sides of the courtyard. In the center lies a large basin which was probably linked to a water well. During the most recent conservation project, an unexpected discovery of the water supply system was made. This system included a water wheel, aqueducts, and cisterns. This system added considerable knowledge to our understanding of water distribution system used at the time. Until this find, little was actually known about this complex matter. The loggia or maq'ad is accessed from the main courtyard through a magnificent trilobe portico with rich masonry decorations. Although the loggia shows the grand features of the Mamluk style, it is however interesting to note that it was a later Ottoman addition to the palace. It was constructed in the 17th century, nevertheless, it followed the same architectural aspects of the palace as a whole and conserved similar proportions, hence does not stand out as an addition to the palace. For the culture review, it's time to look into the Oman Bright Show Carnival, and actually it's an important carnival at its first round. It's an international carnival with more than 8 countries participating from all over the world.
The first Oman Bride Carnival was recently held in the Sultanate of Oman with the participation of several international and Arab countries, including Egypt, Kuwait, the United Arab Emirates, Bahrain, Lebanon, Jordan, Morocco, and India. First Oman Bride Carnival coincides with the Muscat one, and it is held for the first time. It took us 3 years to prepare for the carnival and to be able to gather such a diverse and interesting gathering. And as you can see, I'm wearing the traditional outfit of the Sultanate, as we Omanians value our cultural heritage and traditional dress. The first Oman Bride Carnival is all about brides, their dresses, bridal accessories, jewelry, and wedding decorations, and each country is showing its traditional bridal design. The first round of the Oman Bride Carnival is the first of its kind to be held in the Sultanate of Oman, with the participation of many Arab and international countries who are known for their unique bride designs. We have been preparing for the carnival for a long time, and we exerted a lot of effort to execute it in a proper way. As part of the carnival, a fashion show was held displaying the traditional bridal dresses of the participating countries. The show included bridal dresses from Lebanon, the United Arab Emirates, Morocco, the Sultanate of Oman, Egypt, Syria, and many other participants. Also, the participants displayed engagement dresses and accessories, as well as a variety of evening gowns. I'm honored to attend the first round of the Oman Bride Carnival and to be included among such a unique collection of designers from all over the Arab world. The carnival is characterized by its diversity, the diversity of its designs, and the uniqueness of its fashion styles, especially for the year 2017. I have noticed that this year everything is in fashion, the long dresses, the short dresses, the plain dresses, the tight dresses, as well as the loose ones. I'm happy to take part in the carnival, especially with the participation of such a diverse gathering of Arab countries and top designers for both the bridal dresses and the evening gowns. It is a very competitive event. I made sure that my designs would suit the needs of the bride from head to toes. In my designs, I paid great attention to combine between the Omanian bridal taste as well as the international one. I'm happy to participate in the first round of Oman Bride Carnival, and I'm happy to see such a large gathering of designers, designs and styles as well. In my collection, I made sure that I made conservative yet elegant dresses that would suit all tastes, especially that of the Sultanate, taking in consideration the 2017 fashion trends. Flowers are in fashion this year, so I designed them in a variety of ways. The carnival was concluded by a bride dress fashion as well as a kids fashion show, in addition to the honoring of some of the carnival's participants.
Today in Memories, we're commemorating the memory of the late internationally famous Egyptian singer, songwriter and film actress Umm Kulthum, who passed away on the 3rd of February 1975. Umm Kulthum was known as Planet of the East. She was known for her extraordinary vocal ability and style. She was one of the greatest and most influential Arab singers of the 20th century. At this point in her career, Umm Kulthum was introduced to the famous poet Ahmad Rami, who wrote 137 songs for her. Rami also introduced her to French literature, which he greatly admired from his studies at the Sorbonne in Paris, and eventually became her head mentor in Arabic literature and literary analysis. Furthermore, she was introduced to the renowned composer Mohammed al-Asabghi, who introduced her to the Arabic Theater Palace, where she would experience her first real public success. In 1932, her fame as a singer increased through sales of her records to the point where she embarked upon a major tour of the Middle East, performing in important Arab cities such as Damascus in Syria, Baghdad in Iraq, Beirut in Lebanon, Tunis in Tunisia, and Tripoli in Libya. In 1934, Umm Kulthum sang for the inaugural broadcast of Radio Cairo, the state station. Over the second half of the 1930s, Umm Kulthum became the most popular and famous Arab singer, and she became popular for her appearances in musical movies as well as the live broadcasting of her concerts performed on the first Thursday of each month of her musical season from October to June. Her influence kept growing and expanding beyond the artistic scene, that training royal families would request private concerts from her and even attend her public performances. In 1944, King Farouk I decorated her with the highest level of orders, the Perfection Medal, Nishan el-Kamel, a decoration reserved exclusively to members of the royal family and politicians. Umm Kulthum's musical directions in the 1940s and early 1950s and her mature performance style led this period to becoming popularly known as the Golden Age of Umm Kulthum. in keeping with changing popular tastes, as well as her own artistic inclinations in the early 1940s, she requested songs from composer Zakaria Ahmed at colloquial poet Bayram Ettunsi, casting styles considered to be indigenously Egyptian. This represented a dramatic departure from the modernist romantic songs of the 1930s, mainly led by Mohammed Al-Asabghi. The last collaboration between Al-Asabghi and Umm Kulsum was in 1941 in the song Ra'il Habib, The Lover's Heart Softens, one of her most popular, intricate and high-caliber songs. Simultaneously, Umm Kulsum started to rely heavily on Riyad Sumbati. While Sumbati was evidently influenced by Kasabgi in those early years, the melodic lines he composed were more lyrical and more acceptable to Umm Kulsum's audience. The result of collaboration with Rami Sumbati and Ettunsi was a populist and popular repertoire that had lasting appeal for the Egyptian audience. Around 1965, Umm Kulsum started cooperating with composer Mohammed Abdel Wahab. Her first song composed by Abdel Wahab in Ta Omri, You're My Life, was considered the summit meeting. Several beautiful songs composed by Abdel Wahab followed, such as Amal Hayati, The Hope of My Life, Fakkaruni, They Reminded Me, and many other. Umm Kulsum also sang for composers Mohammed El Mougi, Sayed Mekawi, and Belligh Hamdi. Umm Kulsum sang more than 700 songs and acted in around 6 films. She passed away on the 3rd of February 1975 at the age of 76. Her funeral procession became a national event with around 4 million grief-stricken Egyptians lining the streets to bid her goodbye. We have seen together a variety of interesting topics, and that brings us to the end of this episode of Nile Magazine. Again, in a new episode, it's goodbye.